death at 90 plus. So they know very well that it is going to fall. There is no problem for them. Even at 30 it can happen, even at 60 it can happen. But the problem arises in today's condition. Supposing at that stage, assume somebody rushed him to hospital and that they operate him, they try to resuscitate him, he goes through all hell, right? Then it's a problem. Today what is happening is, whatever is natural death, we are trying to stop that process. When you are trying to stop the process, all this difficulty comes in. But what is natural death and what is not natural death? I as a doctor cannot decide that. For me, every death is unnatural. As a doctor, my job is to protect. So, but this is a natural process. Go to the next slide. It is as simple like a caterpillar and the butterfly. If the caterpillar doesn't die, will the butterfly be there? Right. Such people like your grandfather at 91, they have wanted to be caterpillar. They are voluntarily, they are leaving this body. So there is no struggle on their part. There is no struggle to leave the body, because often we struggle, I don't want to die. We resist, right? But how many of us are there who are willing? They would not have expressed, but there are several who are mentally willing to go. Those who are willing to go, they have no problem, right? Those who refuse to go, they have the problem. So the problem there is, do you want to become a butterfly or not? There is a good poet, Jalaluddin Rumi, he's an Iranian poet. He says, I died as mineral and became a plant. Right? Died as a plant and rose to an animal. Died as an animal and became a man. Why should I fear? When was I less by dying? Nobody is ever less by dying. But still, we don't want to grow. Will a child refuse to grow to a man? Will any child want to be there in the same 7th class, 10th class and say, no, I don't want to go to a man? No. It's a natural process. Here the memory continuity is there, therefore we accept. Where memory continuity is not there, we are not willing to accept. Many children will see, those who are 2-3 year old, before sleeping, they will weep. Why do they weep? Before sleeping, sleep time means they will start weeping. They don't want to go into sleep mode. But nature is forcing them to go into sleep mode. Because they don't want to go into sleep mode, because suddenly they don't want to lose attachment with their sister, mother, father and all that. Right? So they resist. So they weep. Right? But some children happily go. 8:30, 9 o'clock, they will automatically go, because they are assured that there is a tomorrow. They don't think so much. They don't have any fear of losing contact with people. But some have a fear of losing contact. Why that happens? Previous birth. What kind of thought you had? Next. The old man can say, I'll miss you all because I'm going to die. Supposing that is the thought with which he dies. The child will say, Mom, I'll miss you. I can only cry. There is a continuity between these two. Old man at the time of his death thinks that he is going to miss all. That single thought transfers in the memory stick to the new body. Again the association comes in. There is a story in our Puranas about a worm eating an apple. A saint saw this. Just at the time of his death, he just saw that the worm was eating an apple. And the saint was not able to eat anything because he was already in deathbed. All the time he was thinking about it. Next birth, he had all the time wanted to eat only apples and food. Right? Because he was missing that. There is a story about Bartha, you know. He leaves the kingdom, he goes to forest. After all his rule, then he had taken a hermitage. There was a deer he was attached with. He keeps on feeding them. It was a fawn. Mother died because of some tiger attack or something. The fawn was brought up. And all the time he was so much attached. Next birth he becomes a fawn. Otherwise he would not have, being a saint, he would not have had a birth at all. He becomes. There are several such stories. Buddha is supposed to have such a story. Buddha knew about 2,500 of his previous births. In one of his births, people ask him about his compassion. Buddha was very famous for his compassion. He says, in one of the births, I was an elephant. There was a forest fire. I was running because we had to escape the forest fire. I was panting for breath. Fire was still coming. So for a few seconds, I want to take rest by the side of a tree. I stood there just to have a deeper breath. Well, as I stood, a rabbit came and got my protection. It was just under my feet, between my feet. Now, when the rabbit was there, it was a dilemma for me because the fire was coming. If I run away, the fire will attack it. And I didn't want to touch that rabbit which is resting. So I decided to stay till the rabbit goes away because it was also panting for breath, it came. And in the meantime, I got caught in the fire, I died. So compassion was the overriding thought for him in the previous birth as elephant. We did not know this, Jataka, the stories of Buddha is quite large. He is supposed to have remembered so many of his previous birth. So what is important for us, for you and me? Unless we have an equanimous thought right from now, someday, maybe after 40, 50 years, 60 years, 100 years, right? You cannot have that kind of compassionate thought.
And also maybe we'll
have a time.
Pardon me? And also maybe we'll have a time.
You may still have. In spite of all the training, you may still have, because it's not so easy. It's not so easy. But possibly you will not be that much attached. Possibly you will not be that much attached. This is where knowledge comes to be. You can be attached for a few seconds only. Fortunately, today the question arises, the doctor gives you injections, puts you into coma stage, and then somebody dies. What was the thought? He had no thought at all because he was in coma. After that, he died. So what is that he is carrying in his stick?
Huh?
No. Before he goes into coma, what was the thought? Pardon me? Yeah, that will remain. Supposing somebody is in certain state of mind and then the injection is given, the fellow goes into coma. In coma itself, he dies. Now, before his death, he was in a state of comatose stage. Comatose stage means brain was not functioning, thoughts were not there. Then what happens to him? He is carrying a blank one? No. Before he went into coma, what was the state of thought? That is the one which he carries forward. Next question. The next question comes, when you go into cloud, where do you go? You go to the abode of ancestors or you go to the abode of Brahma? There are Brahma Loka, or Surya Loka, Chandra Loka. Generally we say he has gone to Chandra Mandala or he has gone to Surya Mandala. Now these are figurative way of talking. Somebody has gone to Chandra Mandala means Chandra is mind. Moon is mind because moon gets its light from sun. It is a reflected light. Mind does not have its own power, its own light. The consciousness gives light to the mind. Once you have reached a stage of total consciousness and you exit the body in full awareness as conscious person, but without a mind, that means you have gone to Surya. Because Surya is self-illuminary. So sun does not get its illumination somewhere. It's a ball of hydrogen fire. So it does not get any illumination. So people in Hindu system talk about somebody has gone to Chandra Mandala or somebody has gone to this. And somebody has gone to meet his ancestors. No son can ever go and meet his mother if the son is a scoundrel. It's not possible because the thought waves, the mother was a noble lady, let's say. She has gone to certain plane of existence. Right? Son was a scoundrel. Right? He cannot after death go and reach because there is no son mother there. There are planes of thought. This plane of thought and that plane of thought cannot match. They are in different planes. These planes are called lokas. We say loka, right? We say he is in Bhuloka, Patala Loka, all seven lokas are there. Seven lokas are seven planes of consciousness. So it's not physically people go to those places, it's not. So those who have reached moon means they have their mind still active with all the desires, etc. But supposing he has died, like your grandfather, they live very, very long. I don't know, in terms of years, maybe 300 long years, then only they are born. Such people are not born immediately. Those who have desires, very strong desires, they are born immediately. So it's not always, normally our practice is we put the grandfather's name to the grandchild. Normally. Why? Because we think the grandfather has come back. No, it's not always that way. So there could be a 100 years gap, 200 years gap also. It's not necessary that he is born in the same house. No, it could be anywhere else also. Because where he is born depends upon that mother, that father's, that conducive atmosphere in that particular, let's say that particular wavelength. So if you are tuning 98.4 or 102.2, whatever the radio wave, so if those two wavelengths match, it is born there. Otherwise, it's not born. So normally when we talk about people have gone to Surya Loka, Chandra Loka, this is what we actually mean. There is no question of they're going anywhere. We already told you about that. So, but that memory lingering on to the same house, does the prana continue to revolve around the same house? Sometimes we say it is coming as a cow. Sometimes we say it is there as a dog.
But sometimes people can feel them.
Yes. But how that happens, we don't know. When you say people feel, is it because the person? Maybe I have so much attachment to that, I feel. Why another person doesn't feel? So we do not know. I cannot dismiss it, but I can only say, I do not know. There are so many areas which we do not know. We don't know. We don't know. We just don't know. That's why very first day I told you, it may be. I told you about that. We have to have maybe. Because you cannot know. The very body means limitation. In this body, that mind is a limited instrument. With a limited instrument, you want to perceive things which are not possible at all. If there is a vessel which can only hold water up to about 120 degrees, 130 degrees, and you want to pour 500 degrees, it will break. Glass will break. We just cannot. Right? Therefore, there is no way of knowing. There is just no way of knowing. This is where faith takes over. This is where faith takes over. Therefore, no man is totally rational man. It's not possible. What is rationality? It's not possible. Today I am rational, tomorrow I may be emotional. Therefore, I can only say we don't have an answer for this. Nobody can ever say this is it, this is where he is.
So we can't dismiss anybody's faith as such.
No, we cannot. You have no business to dismiss somebody's faith. No, absolutely, you have no business. Unless you are able to give him better option.
Yeah.
You are nobody to go and say, don't be foolish, don't go to the temple. Or don't go to church. No, I have no business to do that. Because that is something so individual. It is between those two individuals, right? All we can, in general, caution is, don't go to several Swamiji's today. They are fake, right? Don't depend upon another human being. Instead, directly go to the God. You don't need a priest. You don't need a broker between you and your God. That much we can say, knowing whatever happens. But even now, there may be several saints amongst our midst, whom we don't know. They are nice people still there in every village, every home, every caste, every community. You cannot dismiss that. That is up to the individual to know. So you have no business to demolish anybody's faith. Hinduism never does it. Hinduism never does it. Hinduism never says such and such a faith is stupid. No. It is not acceptable.
In a house, we can have two types of people.
Yes, you can. Fine. Both are equally right.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Both are equally right. So there is no question of you are siding one and say, no, you are wrong.
Yeah.
No. But let's understand one thing. As children, we are definitely giving them some sort of